out on the 21st of November 2017. The legacy of Robert Gabriel Mugabe is similar to many African leaders of his time and before, who meant well for their people, but allegedly end their presidency embroiled in corruption, nepotism, and cronyism. Even in his death, Robert Mugabe still courts controversy. There are many who view him as an African giant who fought against white supremacy and imperialism. Others are of the view that he squandered many great opportunities to make his country one of the most successful transitioned countries in Africa. Mugabe was a larger-than-life character. Education was his biggest asset, and he ensured that Zimbabweans were educated to the highest levels. His land reforms, though brutal, was meant to equitably distribute the land to all Zimbabweans. This was not the case, as he was accused that his own family and friends grabbed as much land as possible at the expense of his people. On Talking Point tonight, we take a look at Mugabe and see why the man is said to have died a bitter man. His overthrow by his people was a very bitter pill for him to swallow. It is said he died a sad, sad man. My guests are already seated today, and we are going to be looking at the legacy of Robert Gabriel Mugabe. My name is Jay Otiajiman, and welcome to Talking Point. You can reach us on 055-744-6429, 055-744-6429 if you want to contribute to this program. We are live on GTV, live on GBC News. We are on Facebook at Ghana Broadcasting Corporation and around the world on GBCGhanaOnline.com. Let me introduce my guest to you. From my extreme left, he's an affiliate at the Lagos Center for International Affairs and Diplomacy, Nana Yao Mriku. Good evening, sir. Good evening. In the middle is Dr. Kojo Opokuedu, who is a senior research fellow, Institute of African Studies, History and Politics Department. Good evening, sir. And Mr. Ayitomeka Anku is an analyst. Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Okay, let me start with you, Dr. Opokuedu. Mugabe, I want to start on, during his funeral, his family made a rather emotional statement. And I want us to start from that premise, that he died a sad, sad man. What do you think accounts for that rhetoric or that statement put out by the family, that Mugabe died a sad, sad man?
Well, thank you. It seems to me it's all because of his overthrow and the way it was carried out. He lived a very long time, I mean 95 years.
Yes.
And in these years, there were certainly some remarkable moments, some historic moments and so on. I think, first he led his country into independence. And then in the first 10 years, he ruled extremely well, especially with respect to his educational programs and so on. I personally think 10 years should be an ideal. If he had left office after 10 years, he would probably have gone down as one of the best leaders in Africa. But beyond that, there were problems. And the real test of a man is what he leaves behind. Mm-hmm. And what did he leave behind? Two things. One, political consolidation. But two, economic disarray. And notwithstanding the fact that the West and the IMF and the World Bank, through the sanctions, managed to cripple the economy, it happened under him. So these were the difficulties. And I think his family thinks that having sacrificed so much, especially you know, when he went back from Ghana to Mozambique, Zimbabwe, spent some time in prison,
right,
fled to Mozambique,
yes,
at fault, and so on and so forth. So I think in the end, his legacy is a very complex one. It is one that is marred by two things: his long stay in power and the way he managed the land reforms. And of course, a third, how he dealt with dissenting views within the party. Mm-hmm. So these were things that combined to lead to the coup against him. And I think that his family never came to terms with that. They thought that he deserved better, you know. But as I see it, he suffered the fate of most African leaders who tended in the past to stay in power for far too long, and in the process, you know, antagonized so many forces, you know. So I think that's what happened to him.
Let me ask you this. Do you think that his legacy, apart from the fact that he led his country to independence, will stand the test of time?
Thank you very much. Let me say a good evening to the descending viewers. I mean, Mugabe for sure will go down in history as one of the respected African icons that you ever had. And his legacy is one of, it's a complex one, very conflicted. But he will go down in history as one of the formidable African leaders we ever had. It is true that he had the downturns. He had gone through certain difficult situations. And I mean, if you stay in power for 40 years, you can't expect to stay on top of issues for that longer time. It's just like diminishing marginal returns. At a point in time, you get to your peak, you go down. But the legacy that he's left for Africa will go down in history as one of the best. He was the first prime minister of Zimbabwe, the first executive president of that country. I mean, his records as a Pan-Africanist is he's in the rank and file of some of the great Pan-Africanist leaders that we ever had.
That's quite interesting that you say that, because we do know that, yes, he was prime minister for about 7 years. He became president and executive president in 1987. But he crushed all opposition. We knew that for a fact.
Good.
He didn't have any opposition.
Right. You see, one thing that you must also understand is, for we to be preoccupied with the personal character of Mugabe will be to throw a little light, right, on the social historical factors, right, within which he acted. He was responding to a certain political landscape, a certain political circumstance. So for you to really understand how he behaved and how his reign turned out to be, you ought to situate it within that, you know, social historical epoch, right? Of course, if you look at the 1980s, if you look at the 1960s and the 1990s, his challenge to, the Matabele land massacre,
yes,
right down to the emergence of multi-party rule and how he dealt with opposition that he felt were being incited by external forces. It was not more like a hysterical response to the political landscape of the situation, but I mean, he was just trying to do what most African leaders who wanted to stay in power for long had to do to stay in power.
That can be a legacy.
Exactly. But you see, if you are looking at the Pan-African ideals and how he helped in the liberation struggle in South Africa, in Namibia and in Mozambique, the kind of assistance that he rendered to Samora Machel or Frelimo in Mozambique, he has his downturns, he had the downside, but his legacy will go down in history as one of the most respected, and he earned that respect and acceptance among his peers in Africa. And he had a very strong sense of African conviction, even on the international stage. When he knew he had to stand his ground, to maintain the African dignity. We saw what he did. He was very outspoken in terms of Obama and Trump and the rest.
Mr. Anku, I don't know if you agree with both panelists on the legacy of Robert Mugabe, or you have another view as to what he will be remembered for.
Well, I think by and large, I share their point of view. But to add to that, you have to have some sort of historical knowledge about Zimbabwe. If you don't have that, you will continue to make hasty remarks that, when it's measured against the reality, you found yourself quite limited about the concrete reality. Doctor, talk about the first 10 years. I would situate Mugabe within the context of the first 15 years. He was one of the best. He was the darling boy of the West. In fact, when the wife died, he was forced to take a holiday at the Buckingham Palace for 90 days. The first African leader ever. Why would they extend all this to him? Because, yes, Mugabe, at that point in time, obeyed the orders
of the
master.
But history tells us that his trip to London in the year that Sally Hayfrom died was not a very fruitful trip. There was even an attempt to arrest him in London as a citizen's arrest at one point, you know. So, and he was very peeved with the British for even allowing that because he felt it was an embarrassment to him.
That I disagree.
That's what history says.
No, that I disagree. What you were saying happens, yeah, I think that was around 2007. So I disagree with that aspect. What I'm saying is that Mugabe was a fine boy. Until 1998 to 2000, when he raised that unresolved issue of the land question. Hitherto, none of us have been hearing about Mugabe. No, certainly no. It was when he decided to open the Pandora box, then hell broke loose all over the world. That is the beginning of the issue about Mugabe.
So you are situating the problems with Mugabe from 1998 to 2000. We know that the land reforms, the height of it was in 2000. That's when he decided to take. But if you go back to Matabele, the massacre of Matabele, what did they call Gukurahundri? Yeah. That was in 1984.
It actually started in 1983 and
yes,
then 1987.
And then you have the creation of the 5th Brigade, which also happened in 1982. And all of these were atrocities committed by the Mugabe government at that time. So to say, and the West had stopped even paying for the land reforms long before Mugabe, the 2000 issue.
I humbly disagree again with this. It's a historical distortion. There has never been any financial contribution by the West towards land reform in Zimbabwe. Certainly, it has never been true.
If you want to be very historical in analysis,
yes.
The land reform issue started way back in 1889.
1818, yes.
Started ended somewhere in 1950. But even before you go there, in 1979. When they met in Lancaster,
Agreement, yes.
There were two things that came up. One was that by 1990, there is expected to be what they call willing buyer and willing settler. That was the economic condition to the Lancaster Agreement. And the political condition was that by 1980, there ought to be a certain representative of the white minority in the National House of Assembly in Zimbabwe.
20 seats.
Except that the Lancaster Agreement failed to lay the preparatory ground in creating a stable society in the post-independence South Africa, as far as the land issue was concerned. And you even understand that in what you call the economic structural adjustment program in Zimbabwe, when it was introduced there, the World Bank intensified this aggrandizement of land by the white minority in Zimbabwe. So to a very large extent, you have external donors and Western powers, right, also putting more injecting more fire or momentum into the aggrandizement of land by white minority rule. So we ought to situate it in a very historical, you know, trajectory to understand what is really happening in Zimbabwe.
Doc, the land thing became a huge problem, and it's one of the major things people will remember Mugabe.
Yeah. There are two aspects to it. The first is the fact that it happened at all.
Right.
And most white people were not happy with it. But the second, and for me the most important, was how the whole thing appeared to be unplanned and chaotic. In some cases, land were sold to absentee farmers and all
yes.
that. That was what raised the eyebrows all over the world. And so the whole land question was on the table. Don't forget, when he went back to Zimbabwe, he was in prison for 10 years.
Yes.
In those 10 years, the struggle was on. I mean, people like Nkomo and all these were fighting. Then he comes out of prison and then leaves for Mozambique. Now, his mistake, which was quite historic, was not to have really understood that the manner of capturing state power was going to be very important. If they had persisted and fought from the bush to capture power, he would have had the moral courage to carry out sweeping reforms of the land. But he accepted to negotiate. So in Lancaster, you know, he was really limited.
Right.
And he stayed by it. In fact, the fact that the West was so much happy with him was the fact that he kept faith with the consensus in Lancaster until somewhere 2000, when he felt it was time for him to carry out the reforms. So the reforms itself was something that had been on the table for a long time. Mm-hmm. People were not really happy with him, both within Zimbabwe and outside, about how he went dealing with this land question, and how many people from his party, his cronies, his family members seized huge lands. Some of them were not even farmers themselves, you know. So that was the problem. Again, we have to understand that somehow along the line, Mugabe became quite coercive and authoritarian, you know, for a person like Nkomo to have fled, you know, after independence, and the brutality that my two colleagues, you know, alluded to. All were there. Now, somehow, those coercive authoritarian tendencies engendered resentment within the wider society, and he had to deal with it somehow. And in dealing with it, he became even more repressive. So in the long run, we found out that a vicious circle of repression and estrangement, resentment, had been framed in that country, and it continued. So what, when the soldiers moved to take him out, after people had even expected this long ago, the movement for democracy couldn't do it, and so on, because he had constructed a very repressive state machine, you know, in place.
He was very upset that he even had to share power with the Morgan Tsvangirai.
And that is not to take away his Pan-Africanist credentials and his anti-imperialist, you know, posturing and all that. So, as I said, and as he also repeated, his legacy is quite complex. It's quite complex, and that complexity is underscored by the fact that within the period, the forces at play within his own country and also globally, he was very much aware of the global political structure and how it was framed and how to play to it, you know. So I think the land reforms and the way it was carried out was a huge problem, but also a problem was the fact that he was quite intolerant of dissenting views, even within his own party, you know. And that was why the coup against him was so successful. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was so humiliating. They just changed the soldiers in his house, and then they put him on the house arrest and told him, you are no more there. And nobody really opposed it, you know, either in the army or in the larger civil society. So these were the difficulties that he faced, you know, in the 40 years of his presidency.
Mr. Nkuku, but as a Pan-Africanist, we cannot take that away from him. His struggle for independence, he was in Ghana for 2 years, he met Sally, they went back, both of them were arrested at a certain point. His passion to see that his people were free from white oppression cannot be taken away from him. He was a Pan-Africanist to the core. So as an African, where do you place his legacy? Among the greats?
The greatest.
The greatest?
Yes. You see, you can only make a logical deduction of the political economy of Zimbabwe if you really avert your mind to the land question. The land issue dovetails into every facet of the Zimbabwean life, socially, economically, culturally, spiritually. if you take away any of these things, you can't address the issue of Zimbabwe conclusively. You see, the Lancaster Agreement, as my other colleague alluded to, Mugabe was tied somehow. He has his own limitation as a guerrilla fighter to have come from the bush to negotiate with white imperialists. It's understood. In negotiation, you cannot get it all. Doctor was saying that, well, he should have stayed and fight throughout in the bush.
He wanted to do that.
All right. But at a point in time, if you listen to the interview granted by Nkomo, he said that we have sacrificed enough. And if it's about negotiating and maintain the little energy we have and get what we want, then it is reasonable to go and negotiate. Mm. In London, Lancaster House, the issue of right of declaration was the court decision taken by the British that you cannot touch the land issue until after 10 years. That was the caveat in that constitution. So Mugabe was not going to do anything because he had accepted it. In negotiation, you need to compromise at a point. So he did that. Along the line, the issue came up about making resources available, which by then, the peanut farmer who became a president in United States, Jimmy Carter, through his Secretary of State, Vance Root, made a commitment. They actually wrote officially to the negotiation team that, yes, the American government will be willing to make available funding based on decision taken by the British government at the time. So they were given that promise. What happened? They reneged. Mugabe kept faith with that constitution, all those deals, until 5th November 1997, when UK Secretary of State, in charge of international development, Clare Short, wrote a letter to Kumbi Rai, Zimbabwean minister in charge of agriculture and lands, that they are not responsible for the previous administration's commitment towards the land reform in Zimbabwe.
But is that what makes him the greatest Pan-Africanist?
Oh, no. I am coming. I will get there. So Mugabe decided that no, we fought because we want our land. So if they were not going to do what they have pledged, then let's go for our land. That is what Doug described as chaotic. And you know, in World Bank's own report, he said that it's the most revolutionary land reform ever in the annals of world history. It has never happened before anywhere. It has never happened before. It ended in protracted civil war, fratricidal war, in most countries all over the world. But this was done, according to Doug, chaotic. But what did we see? Yes, people hitherto do not have access to land.
Today they have land.
Cronies will have it. Of course, the system could be abused, but we can't say that there is any total sanity in terms of land distribution anywhere in the world. But it happened all right.
Because even when the case went to the Supreme Court, and he lost the case in the Supreme Court, he fired the judges and replaced them with his own. And this is a statement that Mugabe made at that time. He said, "The courts can do whatever they want, but no judicial decision will stand in our way. My own position is that we should not even be defending our position in the courts. This country is our country, and this land is our land. They think because they are white, they have a divine right to our resources. not here. The white man is not indigenous to Africa. Africa is for Africans. Zimbabwe is for Zimbabweans.
Well, you see, I think that Mugabe ought to have known what he was standing up to when he went to Lancaster. He was a Marxist. At least he said that he became one at the Kwame Nkrumah Deo Institute.
Yes.
And so he knew what he was going into. It seems to me that by the time he decided to deal with the land issue, he was under considerable pressure from the ex-combatants, the ex-soldiers, because they were ready to move without him. And in order not to be surprised, he moved in. I think I used to tell my students, and let me say it here, that I found one of the chapters in Franz Fanon's Wretched of the Earth, the third chapter, Pitfalls of National Consciousness. Yeah. So interesting, you know, it describes precisely what happened, you know. And as I keep saying, the real test of a man is what he leaves behind. So let's look at what he has left behind. You know, the land reforms might have been described by the World Bank as revolutionary. And I have my own doubts when World Bank says something is revolutionary, because they are not actually interested in any revolution anywhere in the world. And in spite of that, it was quite chaotic, as I've said. You remember some of the whites in Zimbabwe were given some land in Nigeria by the then president of Nigeria to relocate and go into farming. Now, the whole question of we are blacks and they are white, you know, contradicted his master's position, which ought to be one of class, that there were very rich Africans who belonged to a class that some of the whites also did belong to. Now, why he moved away from a class analysis of the situation in Zimbabwe to a race analysis was just a strategy of power. You know, at a time when his own legitimacy was in serious question and was fighting hard even within his party and the military to maintain his grip on power. And so it seems to me that Mugabe ran into difficulties that he himself ought to have known from the very beginning, because if you are a Marxist and you are waging an irregular war or guerrilla warfare, and you decide to come and negotiate with imperialism, you must know the limitations. The same thing happened to Kwame Nkrumah when in 1951 he accepted the diarchy to share power with the British.
The truth is, both of them dropped their Marxist tag along the line.
Yeah,
it became more of a socialist.
Certainly, but Nkrumah eventually in Conakry, you know, reverted to Marxism. It also happened to Jagan in Guyana. Mm-hmm. So it seemed to have been a better strategy always to create a period within which incoming nationalist regimes would metamorphose into something else. And it happened to Mugabe. As I said, within the first 10 years, or if he wanted to make it 15 years, if he had given up power, created a situation where power could have gone to a new set of people, he would have been one of the greatest leaders in Africa. You know, he was, as you rightly pointed out, one of the best, or if not the best, educated leader in Africa, and probably also of the world.
Yes.
You know, he held multiple degrees, including masters in law.
Lord.
He was ideologically and politically also well prepared. And so these were things that ought to have given him the ability to understand the dynamics and act in accordance, so that he wouldn't find himself in the mess that he found himself. In fact, about 10 years ago, people had predicted that he was going to end in this way if he continued to stay in power. And then, as Franz Fanon says in The Pitfalls of National Consciousness, he became fabulously rich. His wife, Grace, people won't prefer to call her Disgrace, became fabulously rich. People around him and all that. So he lost the moral courage to continue to pursue that radical line, you know, which he had, you know, pursued all through from
let me take us a little bit back, because this is one of the most interesting quotes for me from Mugabe. And if you juxtapose that with what he ended up becoming, it gives you a clear distinction, or you could call it a tale of two halves for Mugabe. And this is 1980, during his inaugural speech. He says, "The wrongs of the past must now stand forgiven and forgotten. If ever we look to the past, let us do so for the lesson the past has taught us, namely, that oppression and racism are inequalities that must never find scope in our political and social system. It could never be a correct justification that just because the whites oppressed us yesterday when they had power, the blacks must oppress them today because they have power. An evil remains an evil whether practiced by white against black or black against white. Eventually, that didn't hold.
Right. I think that's quite an interesting quote from Mugabe. But you see, sometimes when you call for the rains, you have to deal with the mud. And you can't throw the baby away
with the bathwater.
Exactly. So that was what he purported to do. But then in the end, we realized that he had a different legacy to that effect. But if that is the case, like I keep saying, that this ought to be situated within a particular circumstance. What Mugabe did at the tail end of his legacy was a response to a sense of betrayal that he felt had been meted out to him. He felt that the movement for democratic change, right, led by Morgan Tsvangirai, right, was being supported by some external forces to undermine the toil and blood that he and the ex-veterans had put themselves through in winning liberation or independence for Zimbabwe. And that had to be corrected, and he had to entrench himself significantly through any means necessary into making sure that he was the strong man of Zimbabwe. And in the end, it came with some atrocities, you know, to it. How he was intolerant of dissenting opposition views and how he had to crush them in every available means that he can. But if you look at the situation in Zimbabwe, what you could also say is that he could probably have learned what happened to other African leaders, that they didn't want to bow out of power gracefully at a time when they ought to have done that. So even though he wanted to live side by side, there are some scholars who are saying that he only exploited, at the point in time, he exploited anti-imperial and anti-racist sentiment just so to maintain his grip on power, because he realized that by beating that drum, by beating that idea, he was going to win the support. It was more like a populist ideology. You know, we are fighting against a grand giant Goliath, right, an imperial power. So it is only sad that he said something at the time he came in 1980 when he became he won independence for Zimbabwe, and then getting to the latter part. Like I said, it was, in my opinion, I think he was only responding to that sense of betrayal that he
but
felt.
He lost a grip on the economy.
But who betrayed him?
Well,
because if the argument is that the movement for democracy has support from certain Western powers, he at some point has support from China.
Absolutely.
And that is no evidence of an independent autonomous body. So the problem was not just because the movement for democracy has support from abroad. The point was that he had become so unpopular. His own former combatants were not happy with the fact that the land question remained unresolved. The economy was in shambles, partly because of the sanctions and all
yes.
of that.
Mm-hmm.
And so there were real difficulties for him to deal with. And in responding, in dealing with all these difficulties, he became more repressive. That is what the evidence shows.
Right.
You know, and so he was caught, you know, in a vicious circuit from which he could never extricate himself. In fact, in a way, the coup was even good for him. You know, that it moved him out and then he felt, you know, humiliated and so on and so forth. But at that point, there was very little that you could do to survey the economy, to build a society together, to build a united, you know, Zimbabwe. It was so difficult. I've got friends there who are teaching there, and at one point I was going there and they asked me to come with my own dollars because I can't get money. You know, inflation had reached a point where...
At one point it was the highest in the world.
Yeah, one of the highest in the world. And pensioners were suffering because your whole pension money for a man could buy you a bread. You know, that kind of thing. Of course, there was the external aspect to it, the World Bank and IMF, the way they tried to, you know, cripple him and all that. But the most important thing for us to recognize is that these forces notwithstanding, he himself as an individual had his own role in history. And he must have been aware of what he was doing because as someone who was that educated, you know, who way back in Ghana, I was reading this morning, had even imported copies of Das Kapital.
Das, yeah.
you know, and was engaged with political economy, philosophy, and the state and revolution. So you must have been aware of all these things. Now you enter into an agreement that limits you considerably. You know, so in a sense,
but couldn't it have been that his ideological inclination as a Marxist or a socialist also contributed to his perpetuation of dominance in power as a leader?
Yeah, but see, the point is that even his
and this is somebody who said that look, until God comes, he's not going to relinquish power.
Yeah, but I mean, I doubt his Marxist credential because he seemed to be.
Well, you know, you see, it's like a football game when you are a spectator, you know everything about the game, but when you get in, you now understand the dynamics that, you know, evolves around the game. See, if you were part of those, I'm referring to Doc, at the bush, and then you fought for close to 10 years, and now your enemy said, look, we want to talk to you. Let us now negotiate. We think that, look, we can continue fighting, but the end result is that we have to talk. And that is where peace and security will prevail. I mean, every reasonable person will accept that offer.
Yeah, but then
I didn't interject. Let me. You see, Shidrack Ramphal, Commonwealth Secretary General, 1975 to 1999, he said he was the advisor to Nkomo and Mugabe at the time. Go and read what he said about the negotiation. At a point, this is a British citizen, he advised Mugabe to leave the negotiating table because of the clause that were being imposed on them.
And did they leave?
All right. Then Nyerere came in and said, no. Look, it is just about 6 months for the British to leave. This is strategic thinker. Let us grab the power. Anyhow, it is handed over to us. If we get it, then we will know what we will use it for. It's just as the same Nkrumah said.
Why? The political kingdom.
Exactly. It's strategy.
None of these leaders followed the path that Mugabe followed.
It's not about, you see, the circumstances about all these leaders is not the same. All right. But what we are running away from is that the imperialists are always at their best game. Harold Wilson created a very dangerous economy for Ghana. The Ghana's economy plummeted, cocoa price fell all the way to a single digit, culminating to the 1966 coup. Tony Blair did the same thing, crashed the Zimbabwean economy. It's the only country we have in Africa today that for the last nearly two decades is unable to access funding from any multilateral institution. So far as that institution holds an interest connected to the West. In 2005, IMF said that, well, they are owing $210 million. If they are able to clear that, then their right to vote and access international funding will be restored. They paid. What happened? Embargo. As we speak to you now, Zimbabwe is still under economic sanction. Let's ask ourselves, can Ghana exist today as a viable economy, if there is, quote unquote, without a single dollar coming from any donor nation? Remember, even common toilet, we need to go for loan in order to construct toilet. But Zimbabwe is still Zimbabwe today for close to 20 years without accessing any funding from any institution.
All right,
let me hold you. That is a very dynamic economy that we are talking about, irrespective of the difficulties they are going through. It's a very hot economy, but they are still surviving. It shows the African resilience.
Well, Ms. Anku, we'll come back to the discussion. It's getting interesting here. We'll take a quick break, and when we come back, we are looking at the legacy
of Robert Gabriel Mugabe. We'll be back.
And paperless at the port.
No, we are here for all of us, our interests, not for any individual interest.
As for paperless, no dear.
But we need more education.
Any situation which throws light is a good situation. Eye on Port is a perfect intervention.
Eye on Port is also adding to the growth of the countries going forward in development.
Eye on Port has come to upgrade and promote the industry.
Eye on Ports, showing this and every Wednesdays at 8:30 p.m. on GTV. Eye on Ports, transparency in doing business and building nation. Proudly brought to you by...
So sorry, miss, but I really need a job right now.
She's the star of the nightclub. And she's a nanny of seven spoiled kids. One role falls in the daytime, the other at night. Yet both are the same star. My heart is yours.
You know I don't know much about children, mother.
The witch!
Trouble, fun, a family, but most of all, true love.
Go on and dance, because you owe me hard cash.
Trained to catch a millionaire.
The nanny wins Fernando's heart.
If Anna tries to steal Fernando from me, I swear I'll...
My heart is yours. Hit your screens from Monday to Friday, every week at 9 p.m., and on Saturdays at 8 p.m. My heart is yours is brought to you by Adonko, Hisense, and Deluxe Paint.
Okay, welcome back to Talking Point. Let me take some of your messages coming to us. The topic today, the legacy of Robert Gabriel Mugabe, is a very suitable topic for the day. In the first place, I will not agree with your submission that he died a sad man. That's not my statement. That's the statement from the family. If you listen carefully to the funeral, the family said he died a sad, sad man. I believe he's a man to be celebrated as a Pan-Africanist, and for he fought for his people. Relating to land reforms, as your panelists said, Mugabe was on top of his game. He's a real leader. He must be considered, we must consider him as such. We can look at his failures and achievements, but Mugabe should be considered an African hero. Kudos to your panelists. They have really dealt with the subject. Mugabe was a man of passion for his people. He's a force to reckon with at in this age. Professor Kudoyo sent us this one. President Mugabe was one of the many African rulers who became despots and led his country into economic mess. He turned a food exporting country at the time of independence into a country that couldn't feed itself. He turned citizens into millionaires who couldn't afford a loaf of bread due to hyperinflation. He totally collapsed the economy of Zimbabwe, and nobody should hide these facts. Kofi Ama from Tema sent us this. Zinde Kira Manawe, which means our land is our prosperity, is what destroyed the Mugabe-led administration and, of course, the Zimbabwe downfall. Interesting discussion. Doc, well said. Yes, the East supported Mugabe, and the West did same for the MDC. The difference here was that the East supported Mugabe to develop the country, whereas the West gave support to Morgan Tsvangirai to destabilize the country. From William in Laboni. All right, gentlemen. So, there's a new Zimbabwe. And let's look at what, even in death, there's controversy as to where he should be buried. But I think that is normal with every state. We had our own a few years ago. So when we look back at the legacy of Robert Mugabe in 10 years, what will the history books say?
You mean 10 years from now?
From now.
Well, that. We can read from what is happening currently. I mean, there is some kind of disillusion, you know, that the taking Mugabe away from power and bringing him on Mnangagwa was going to create some significant economic restructure in Zimbabwe. But as it happens now, it's almost the same.
But that's exactly what Ms. Angu is talking about.
It's the same thing I'm saying, it's not the politics, it's not the personality.
If I may, it is
the policies, it's not the personality. So far as
that is why
policy that undermine the interests of imperialists,
that is why
you will pay through your nose. They did it to every other progressive, revolutionary, Pan-Africanist leader. So you can't expect any other policy that will be evolved to take Zimbabwe
forward. Right, I'll come back.
It appears you're on the same side by refusing to appreciate the path to where we are getting to.
Right.
I have said that to dominate or to be preoccupied with the personal character of Mugabe will do very little to illuminate the social, political, historical trajectory into what is happening within that country. And so, of course, if you take the personalities out, Mnangagwa, it is not going to be a one-day change, right? It's going to take time.
But the policies that the IMF, the World Bank, the Bretton Woods, and the Western countries took was as a result of his posture, Mugabe's posture. And that's why that happened to him?
To some extent, I would agree with that. To some extent, because he was not ready to give in to this multilateral bourgeois neoliberal agenda, right? I mean, he has said that Zimbabwe.
But he also contributed to the policies that these people.
But you see, sometimes you ought to be entrenched. You ought to have an entrenched opinion. These are lands. These were lands that belong to the people of Zimbabwe and not any other people. I mean, if South Africa had failed to deal with that issue of expropriation without compensation,
right,
not with Mugabe, and he stood his ground. He was just doing what was a natural birthright of Africans who own their land, their ancestral land that has been dispossessed from them. So his reaction to the neoliberal bourgeois agenda of the West was only a natural response to what they felt had to be done, in my opinion. And that obviously engendered some hostility from the West, which will affect how they want to stifle. And see, I think in 2003, the Bush administration implemented what we call ZIDERA, Zimbabwe Democratic Empire Reform Act.
Yeah.
And that was very devastating, right? Targeting some senior members of Mugabe's party. So to a very large extent, I think it was the West and what they did to, you know, Zimbabwe was a response to some of the action that Mugabe took, in my opinion.
All right, Zangu.
Yeah, I think what he just mentioned refers to Bush. That is Zimbabwe Economic Recovery and Democracy Act. That whole act must be also analyzed contextually. It's linked to Zimbabwe involvement in the support that they gave to Kabila and the involvement of American commandos.
The fact that he sent troops to
commandos. And what happened to Americans? The number of body bags that they took was a retaliation that Bush took against Zimbabwe. We can discuss that, but that is a different topic altogether. But you see, if you have an economy where the entire world have imposed economic blockade on you, how do you expect to power your electricity?
But the question is, Mr. Anku, there must have been a reason why the whole Western world or the whole economic bloc, like you say,
yes,
imposed sanctions.
Yeah, I made a reference to the letter written by Clare Schott,
right,
saying that British government has no responsibility or interest in making available funding for compensation for land reform.
Right.
Then Mugabe said, to hell with you. What do you mean? How do you understand international politics
and diplomacy?
So his rhetoric
also contributed.
It is not about rhetoric. It is not about rhetoric.
What is it about?
You see, the letter written by Clare Schott is nothing but inimitable, shameless, and sanctimony have been displaced by a racist administration, and they have always been at it like that. How could you have said that despite Ghana government signed an agreement with Togolese government to compensate for the death of a number of Togolese citizens or Togolese property that have been confiscated by the previous administration, and that because you were not in power at the time, that you will not be responsible for that agreement. But it cannot be that. No. The debt that Ghana has accrued over the years, this current administration is bound to pay. What I'm saying is that
the last word.
Kleshot letter was the one that stoked the fire. And you cannot say that Mugabe should just sit down aloof and look at the injustice to be continued by just 4,000 white farmers against 12 million Africans.
Okay.
Will you be happy? Let me just ask you this question. Will you be happy when tomorrow you return back to your hometown and people from different area have come to grab your land and say that you have no right, you can't farm. If you want to build, come to us. What will you have done? So you expect that Mugabe should just sit down?
No, I don't think anybody expects
to betray the people. You see, the land issue, more people have died in South Africa than in Zimbabwe with respect to the land
question.
All right,
I have to move on now. My time is... Doc, I'll give you the last word.
Yeah, I think, first of all, we all recognize the inordinate power of imperialism.
Yes.
And, Mugabe also, I'm sure, understood it. I also understand that Mugabe was an astute politician. And he knew what he was doing. But you see, we need to answer a few questions. For example, as I keep saying, asking, what did he leave behind?
Mm-hmm.
What were the objective consequences of his actions? Was there an alternate system of development? What would have been the best tactics of advancing in the conditions that he found himself? You know, and I always say that there's one significant difference between law and politics. In law, intentions matter. You know, if I'm accused of killing somebody, the judge wants to know if actually I intended to do that. Otherwise, I can be rather charged with manslaughter and so on. But in politics, intentions don't matter so much as the objective consequences of your actions. You may want to do something good, but if you result in a bad situation for your people, that's how you are going to be judged. Now, it's quite evident that Mugabe left behind an economy that is in disarray. There's no question at all about that. I'm not here so much interested in whether imperialism was responsible or not. Cuba has been under economic blockade for a very long time. The Chinese found a way to build what they call Chinese socialism with Chinese characteristics. And today we all know what China is.
Yes.
So things have been done in a different way. What were the original aims and objectives of ZAPU or ZANU-PF?
Yes.
Did they achieve it? Or did they achieve them? You see, so for me, two things are important. Whilst he was able to put his people together, to hold his people together, to achieve a measure of political consolidation, there is an economy that is in complete disarray. And that, for me, is quite important. He was a great person, and his greatness was founded on his undying love, you know, for his people. It was founded on that irrevocable commitment to that radical ideology of Pan-Africanism and all that. But in the end, we need results. What happened? Are Zimbabweans living better today than they were 40 years ago when he took power? The answer is no. The future looks quite bleak. The country is on the verge of very terrible collapse. And all these are traceable to his period of governance. Notwithstanding the fact that the West, World Bank, IMF, also contributed. So in assessing this man, we have to be quite objective and look at what he could have done differently. Nkrumah and so many other people before him failed. And he had all those examples to guide him. You know, the fact of staying in power for 40 years, four decades, itself is quite problematic.
Okay.
It's quite problematic. And I'm not saying that they should be changed for change's sake, but you always need to have, you know, some inspiring and refreshing ideas. All over, that's the problem of the African.
All right. Thank you very much. Let me take some messages before we go. Mugabe should have known that if he could not beat the imperialists, he should have relinquished power quickly as Nelson did to save his face, instead of creating economic hardships for his people. May his soul rest in peace.
Great submissions from Nana Yao regarding Mugabe's legacy in Zimbabwe and Africa as a whole. A great Pan-Africanist whose legacies remain unparalleled among his peers. Mark from Lesiad. The panelists are hitting the nail right on his head. Constructive argument from Abata in D.C. I'm solidly in support with Mr. Anku. Seibu Hussein, history teacher, Ghana Senior High School, sent us this one. Listen to the quote from Mugabe in 1980. He could have meant his words, but afterwards the pressure may come from the people, or the way the people are treating his people made him tougher. Yaya sent us this one. If you really want to know whether Mugabe was a hero or villain, then read about the Lancaster agreement. And I think we've said a lot about the Lancaster agreement today. But let me leave you with a quote. And unfortunately, time for us is almost gone. But this quote is very important. It says, the story of Robert Mugabe, and this is put together by Heidi Holland. And she says, the story of Robert Mugabe is a microcosm of what bedevils African democracy and economic recovery at the beginning of the 21st century. It is a classic case of a genuine hero, the guerrilla idol who conquered the country's former leader and his white supremacist regime, turning into a peevish autocrat whose standard response to those suggesting he steps down is to tell them to get lost. It is also the story of activists who tried to make a better society but bear the indelible scars of the old system. Mugabe's political education came from the autocrat Ian Smith, who had learned his formative lessons from imperious British colonizers. Heidi Holland sent us this one. So thank you very much, gentlemen. I think that our time is far spent, and we would like to... maybe I'll give you all 30 seconds to wrap up, and then we'll see. My producer tells me I have 1.5 minutes more, so what's your final on?
My final... A great man, indeed he's a great man. I mean, most great men also had, you know, their own downturn to whatever kind of reign that they had. And Mugabe was no exception. As human as he was, he made some unpardonable mistakes. And you can't dissociate his mistakes from his achievement. But he'll go down in history, particularly African history and world history. Like I said, he had a very strong sense of conviction as far as African personality is concerned. And that anytime he spoke out there on world platform, I felt represented as an African who wanted to present it as such with human dignity.
All right.
And Mugabe will go down in world history as one of my greatest African
Thank icons. You very much, Nana Yao Miriku, affiliate from Lesia. Now, Doc, a great man.
Yeah, certainly he was. I mean, he was a great man, but he lived at a time when imperialism had become more dangerous, and he had the experiences, the lessons of others before him to learn from. That he fell by the same way as those before him did is an indictment. And I think his legacy is a very complex and a mixed one. We still have a lot to learn from him. As Africans continue the search for unification and for progress.
Okay. Dr. Kojo Opoku-Edu is a Senior Research Fellow, Institute of African Studies, History and Political Department. Finally, Mr. Anku.
Mugabe was very witty, sophisticated, thoughtful, and above all, ruthless. He would deal with his enemies if he has a justifiable ground to deal with them. But when the roll call is made, he will be part of those greatest African doyens that ever walk on the surface of this earth. He carried the torch. He never bended. He has never capitulated to imperialist oppression. That, for me, make him one of the distinguished African personalities ever.
All right, Mr. Ayitomeka Anku is an analyst. Thank you very much, gentlemen. And my take on all of this is that, like Shakespeare says, cowards die many times before their death. The valiant never taste of death but once. Certainly, Mugabe was no coward. He's too tall among his peers. And in my opinion, he is the last African giant of his era. There shall be no other like him. My name is J.O.T. Ajuman, and this is Talking Point.
Where do you live?